Welcome, everyone. So this is the second of our MPH Insight series for this year. So the aim of the webinar series that we've got here at GRI is to share independent and objective thought leadership in the area of pension research that will hopefully lead to innovative solutions in pension design, governance, and the investment challenges that we have. Through the National Pension Hub, we at GRI want to act as an unbiased source for policy consultation. So today I'm pleased to introduce our guest speaker, Professor Antoon Pilster, for today's session. So Antoon, as Vandus mentioned, is a professor of finance and actuarial science at Maastricht University and the University of Amsterdam. He works as an independent consultant in the field of market consistent valuation of insurance and pension contracts. Professor Pilster is also a research fellow at NetSpar and has worked with leading financial institutions around the world. In his research, he focuses on risk management for banks, insurance companies, and pension funds. And a special area of attention is the impact of model uncertainty on the valuation and hedging of risks in insurance and pension contracts. Antoon, I'll leave it up to you to kick us off.
Okay, Bruce, thank you very much for your nice invitation and your nice introduction. Let me see if the magical page down button works. Yes, it does. Excellent. Okay. So I think what my talk is going to be about, you guys made some very nice marketing effort by saying what's the best pension system in the world. I'm afraid I'm not quite going to answer that question in full, but what we're going to do is at least compare two of the best pension systems in the world with each other, and we're going to look at the supervision or the regulation systems. So basically, we're going to compare in a stylized setting the Dutch regulations, the Dutch pension regulation system, and the Canadian pension regulation system. And we're going to do kind of a stylized comparison where we kind of take a hypothetical pension fund, and the only thing we do is we place that pension fund either under Dutch regulation, or we place that exact same pension fund with exact same investment strategy, with exactly the same development of the economy. We're going to place that under the Canadian regulation, and then we're going to see what the distribution of outcomes of the pension result is under, let's say, for when we compare this side by side. As was mentioned in the introduction, this research was sponsored jointly by NetSpar and by GRI and the National Pension Hub. So we are very grateful to both sponsors to enable us to do this research and to make this comparison. So what is the research question that we are interested in? What pension funds typically do is they base their financial policies on ALM type of models with long-term projections. And pension funds typically have a rather long-term, let's say, planning horizon to kind of optimize their investment strategies and such. Whereas at least the Dutch supervision system focuses quite strongly on the short term, and is very strongly focused on market value. So basically, at the end of every year, the market value of the assets in the pension fund is compared with the market value of the liabilities. The ratio of those two numbers is a so-called funding ratio. And let's say, roughly speaking, that the funding ratio should be larger than 100%. Otherwise, basically, the Dutch regulator steps in and you have to change certain things to get back to 100%. And that shows kind of a tension between the inherent long-term nature of the liabilities in the pension fund and kind of the long-term planning horizon that pension funds use, versus, at least in the Dutch system, this kind of 1 year solvency type of focus. And the Dutch pension regulation is, let's say, partly inspired by the Solvency II type of regulation that is being used in Europe for the supervision of pension funds. So what triggered this research project was a way, let's say, can we kind of help or compare or, inform the regulator how in an optimal supervision context, they should make a trade-off between the following two objectives. First, there should be kind of long-term sufficiency. So is the pension fund able to pay out the indicated pensions? And this is kind of typically what is studied in an ALM type of setting. And then you can kind of give a probability distribution of the outcomes of what each participant is going to get. So this is kind of long-term sufficiency and is on average over a long planning horizon of 40 years, is the payout to the participants, let's say, sufficiently good? Is there sufficient indexation in there, etc.? And on the other hand, you have this kind of short-term discontinuity requirement. If the pension fund or if the sponsor kind of falls away today and there are no more premiums coming into the pension fund, would the value of the assets today be sufficient to cover the liabilities to the participants? And that's kind of the trade-off, and at least in the Dutch supervision system, that tension was quite strongly visible, and at least the pension funds in the Netherlands complained fairly loudly about this tension. I'm clicking on to the next slide. So what we do in this study is that we are making a comparison between the two different supervisory regimes. We're going to compare the Dutch supervision framework with this relatively strong focus on the short term, and we're going to look at the Canadian supervision framework, and that has much more kind of a long-term focus. And why did we choose Canada in particular? Is that Canada is also a very nice example of having a very well-developed and well-regulated pension sector. But as from this comparison point of view, the Canadian supervision framework is much more focused on the going concern than compared to the Dutch and the European regulation frameworks. Maybe before I go, let's say a little bit more detail about the Dutch regulation versus the Canadian regulation, are there any questions so far or any comments?
Doesn't seem to be anything in the chat there, Anton.
Okay.
Keep on going.
Okay. I saw a red number 5, but now I realize that this is the slide number and not the number of questions that are... because the red number 5 was just hovering about above the chat. Okay. So to give a very short recap about how the Dutch regulation works is, first of all, the Dutch pension system and the Dutch supervision also recognize a 3-pillar structure. So the first pillar are pension benefits which are being paid out by the Dutch government, and they are paid out on a pay-as-you-go basis. And this is kind of a general, let's say, basic old age benefit that you get on the day that you retire, and it's financed via a pay-as-you-go system. And the Dutch abbreviation for this pension benefit is AOW. Which is a letter word of 3 Dutch words that I'm not going to say here. Then on top of the first pillar, you have the second pillar, and that is in principle every employee in the Netherlands has mandatory participation in a pension plan. And the way that pension plans are organized in the Netherlands is that it's either organized per individual company. And typically, large companies tend to have their own individual pension funds, Philips or Unilever, or you name some large Dutch companies, they have their own individual pension funds. Or there are basically industry-wide pension plans. So basically, all the metal workers together, they are sitting in one single pension fund. All the people who work in the supermarket branch are participating together in the supermarket pension fund, so to speak. All the Dutch civil servants, are sitting in the civil servants pension fund, which happens to be of the largest pension funds in the world. And basically, you have no choice. Depending on where you work, there is a unique pension plan dedicated to that particular type of work that you do. In recent years, the number of self-employed people has rather quickly grown, also for kind of blue-collar workers like builders and stuff like that. And there they kind of slip in between, let's say, they kind of fall in between the cracks of the Dutch law. So there is no mandatory participation yet for self-employed workers. But I think the new Dutch government has put on the agenda, on the political agenda, as one of the points that there should also be kind of a pension plan participation for self-employed workers. So that was the first pillar. And the second pillar, and the third pillar, are voluntary retirement savings. And you can either do some kind of topping up via the workplace pension system that you are in, or you can go to insurance companies and banks, and then there are kind of, let's say, designated savings or investment accounts. It can be pure savings, or it can be, you can invest in equity markets or in some indices, or you can do a mix of saving and investing in indices. And both insurance companies in the Netherlands and banks in the Netherlands offer these kind of designated savings and investment accounts. And they are kind of tax friendly, but they are kind of locked. So if you want to use the tax break, then basically you can put money into the pension, into that designated account, but you cannot take any money out before your retirement date. I think I saw a question popping in. I think there was a question from Nadine. Do all workplace pensions offer the voluntary top-up? I believe so, yes. But I'm not 100% sure. But I do believe that you have this kind of voluntary top-up options. Okay, then I am moving to the next slide. So how does the Dutch regulation work? The Dutch law that, let's say, is used, the name of the Dutch law is kind of the new financial assessment assessment law, the new financial toetsingskader. And what is perhaps a little bit surprising is it's strongly focused on the nominal funding ratio. So the way that it works is that you say, we assume a kind of a discontinuity scenario. So we assume that as of today, the sponsor falls away and there are no new premiums coming into this pension fund. So you have this kind of, let's say, you hypothetically assume that the pension goes into a runoff type of situation. From that runoff type of situation, you look at the nominal pensions that have been promised to the participants that are currently in the fund, and those nominal pension liabilities, so that is without any indexation potential or promise, you basically say, I have a set of nominal cash flows that the pension fund is currently promising implicitly to pay out to their participants. And we used, under the Dutch law, you then have to use the current market term structure of risk-free interest rates to basically discount all those nominal cash flows back to today. Of course, there was a lot of political negotiation. Yeah, is the market sufficiently representative? So after a good Dutch, in the good Dutch, Dutch tradition, there was a compromise. And the way it's currently working is that you follow the market term structure of interest rates, of risk-free nominal interest rates up to 20 years. And then at the 20-year point, you start detaching from the market term structure. And then you kind of move to a little bit higher interest rate, which is the ultimate forward rate. So it's mostly market driven, but then for the very long term interest rates, there is kind of a little bit higher interest rate that's being used. So that is the way that you compute the basically the market value of the nominal liabilities. And then a pension fund in the Netherlands is then required to say, I take the market value of my current assets, I compute the market value of these nominal liabilities, and I take the ratio of these two numbers. And roughly speaking, that ratio that ratio should be larger than 100%. Yes. So the actual cutoff point is not at 100%, but at 104.5%. So if your funding ratio in any year falls below the 104.5% mark, then you basically get into a type of distressed pension fund situation. But there is not immediately bad things are happening. First of all, you have to the Dutch supervisor, the Dutch central bank, goes to the pension plan and says, well, you have to make a recovery plan. How do you believe that you are going to recover from your current funding ratio below 104 back to the 104 mark? And you get a 10-year period for this to do this recovery. And basically, during that recovery period, you can no longer give any indexation to your participants, and you have to kind of deliver as part of the recovery plan, you have to say, this is the investment policy that I'm going to follow, maybe with this amount of premium increases and stuff like that. And you have to give that plan to the supervisor, and the supervisor has to kind of say yes, and that plan has to be backed up by an ALM type of study showing that there is sufficiently recovery potential there. And then when the Dutch supervisor says okay, then you go into this kind of recovery phase. And when the recovery plan would fail after this 10-year period, then basically the Dutch regulator steps in and forces the pension funds to make a mandatory cut in the pension entitlements of the participants to basically get this funding ratio back to 104.5 by basically cutting the pension entitlements down. So then basically the pension entitlements are basically cut down such that they are consistent with the market value of the assets again. So that was the theory. However, because of the very low interest rates in Europe, in the Netherlands, we have negative interest rates at the moment, and interest rates are ridiculously low at levels like between 0.5% and 1%. So if you discount at those very low interest rates, of course, the market value of your liabilities is very large. So the majority of Dutch pension funds are basically in this kind of red zone, and that already started a few years ago. So in 2020, it looked like that there was a considerable amount of Dutch pension funds that would have to cut their, that would have to make these mandatory cuts. But then the Dutch minister gave kind of a one-time exception to the pension funds by saying, as long as your funding ratio is not below the 90% mark, the mandatory cuts are kind of off the table and you are kind of allowed to continue with your recovery plan. And the reason for doing that is that, as we speak, the Dutch pension system is kind of completely transitioning to a new type of regulation. Because we found out the hard way that it's great to do these funding ratios and market values, but if the majority of the pension funds gets into trouble, then basically it doesn't work. So instead, we start redesigning the regulation and the supervision system. And basically what's happening, and this is, of course, a very, very short summary, we are basically abolishing any notion of a nominal guarantee from the Dutch pension system. So we are kind of moving completely to a defined contribution system where there are no nominal guarantees anymore. And therefore, pension funds, Dutch pension funds, don't have to compute a funding ratio anymore. And then again, as part of a Dutch political compromise, there will be some kind of solidarity buffer, because the labor unions in the Netherlands were very worried about what they call lucky and unlucky generations. If the investment results are good, you have a cohort of people retiring with a very nice and rich pension. And then when the investment returns are bad, you have a subsequent cohort retiring with a lot lower pension. And the Dutch labor unions were quite worried about that. So they said there has to be a solidarity buffer that we can kind of use to smooth out the differences between generations out over time. And basically, as we speak, this year and this summer, the new Dutch government, because we had elections in March, the new Dutch government is going to hammer out, together with the social partners in the Netherlands, is going to hammer out exactly all the details of how this new pension system and how this transition is going to work. Talking about the short term and the long term trade-off, there is kind of a remnant of a long-term perspective, and this is called kind of the long-term feasibility test. In the Dutch word, it's the haalbaarheidstoets, which is abbreviated as HBT. And there the pension fund are going to do an ALM type of study where they provide insight to the regulator and to their participants in the cohesion and the continuity of the financial structure of the pension funds, what the expected pension results are, and what the associated risks are. And what I think is rather nice is that there is a standardized set of stochastic scenarios over a horizon of 60 years with, I think, 1,000 scenario paths. And that stochastic set contains of nominal interest rate term structures, stochastic inflation, and stochastic stock index developments. And this kind of standardized stochastic scenario set is published by the Dutch Central Bank on, I think, on a quarterly basis. And they use an official model, which is constructed by an external group of experts, and they're called the Parameter Committee. And I think every 5 years, the Parameter Committee comes together again, and they kind of re-update. They say, is this still the right model? And they also kind of say how the model should be calibrated to the available data. The outcome of this feasibility test is mainly for information. So there are kind of no hard requirements. So this is like more for information, and it's a lot kind of softer in terms of hard requirements than this funding ratio. That's kind of a really important and hard thing in what used to be the Dutch pension supervision. Are there any questions so far? Because this kind of concludes my three-slide overview of the Dutch pension regulation. I think there are no questions. So then I'm going to give a very short description of the Canadian system. Again, the Canadian system also consists of this three-pillar setup. The first pillar is pension benefits by the state. Then the second pillar is the Canada or the Quebec pension plan, with mandatory, which is a mandatory public pension plan for workers over 18. And then the third pillar is either a mandatory or voluntary retirement savings, and it can either be a DB or DC type of plans. What we're going to do for our, let's say, comparison is we're going to look at a defined benefit workplace pension in Canada and the regulation around that. So the Canadian regulator is the Office of the Superintendent of Financial Institutions, the OSFI, and that regulator also regulates banks and insurance companies and trust companies. And this is quite similar to the Netherlands. In the Netherlands, we have the Dutch Central Bank that basically regulates as well banks and insurance companies and other financial institutions. And of course, in the Netherlands, we have this kind of two-tier system that officially the regulator is the European regulator, but a lot of the day-to-day supervision activities are delegated then back to the national supervision authorities. So most Dutch pension funds basically speak to the Dutch central bank, and also most Dutch banks speak to the Dutch central bank, and they rarely speak to the European central bank or the European insurance supervisor. The Canadian regulator, is my understanding, is the regulation, the Pension Benefit Standards Act and Regulation from 1985. So it's been around a bit longer than the Dutch regulation. And you have an actuarial standard of practice describing the calculation methods. There is basically a going concern type of valuation. You have this continuity assumption, and there you can use expected investment returns on the fund's assets, or you can reflect the yield of your fixed income investments. And there is also a solvency type of valuation, which works under a discontinuity assumption. And there you then determine the value of the pension entitlements, assuming that there are no surpluses or deficits in the pension fund. And what kind of requirements are being imposed by the Canadian regulation? You have requirements on the funding. So a pension fund may not have a going concern deficit, and a pension fund may also not have a solvency deficit. And in the case where a deficit occurs, then the sponsor must make special payments into the fund. And these are kind of, it's like a 15-year recovery period where the sponsor can make annual payments over a period of 15 years. And when the sponsor cannot make the payments, then the pension fund, the Canadian pension fund, would enter into a so-called distressed pension plan workout scheme, where you have kind of a recovery plan, and also, let's say, refunds of surpluses to the sponsor are possible in the Canadian system, but there are rather strict conditions on let's say, making payments back from the pension fund back to the sponsor. Are there any questions or comments on my summary from the Dutch, from the Canadian regulation system? I think Kim Page is saying, note that in Canada, there are also pension regulators in every province, and that they all have somewhat different funding requirements. The OSFI only regulates about 7% of the private pension plans in Canada. Oh, that's a good one. Yes, we will take note of that, or at least I hope that Sally takes a note of that, and then we will take that into consideration. So thank you for this clarification. So what kind of comparison did we gonna make? It's a bit tricky to kind of, let's say, make a comparison. So, and we thought quite a bit about this. So the way that we were gonna do, or that we actually decided to do the comparison, is we wanna focus on just the impact of having a difference in regulation. That's what we are kind of want to look at. And the way we set this up is by saying, let's take a look at the hypothetical pension funds. And this hypothetical pension fund is exposed to exactly the same economic scenario set. It is using exactly the same investment strategy, and it contains of exactly the same group of participants. The only difference that's going to happen to this hypothetical pension fund, it's either going to be hypothetically placed in the Netherlands and then fall under the Dutch pension regulation, or under the exact same economic scenarios, it's going to be placed in Canada, and then it's going to be subjected to the Canadian regulation. And then we kind of take all the differences between the euro and Canadian dollar and interest rates. We're going to take that out, and we're kind of very cleanly focus on just the difference in the regulation and what is the impact on basically the probability distribution of outcomes for the participants in the pension funds. And the way we're going to compare the outcomes is we're going to do an ALM type of study using exactly this kind of official HBT scenario set that the Dutch Central Bank is publishing anyway. And we're going to look at the probability distribution of nominal and real pension benefits at retirement of a cohort of participants. And we're going to look at three regulation schemes. The first is a no regulation scheme at all, where basically the pension fund just continues to invest in the same asset mix, whatever happens. And if at the end of the period, the pension fund ends up being underfunded, it basically says, well, this is the amount of money we're going to get, and we're going to distribute the available amount of money to the participants in the pension funds at retirement. So basically, you're going to cut the pension benefits at retirement to make the benefits match the market value of the assets which are then sitting in the pension funds. And the second type of regulation is obviously the Dutch regulation, which is kind of very strongly focused on this solvency ratio and this market value and this this solvency ratio type of regulation. And then if the solvency ratio or the funding ratio, I should say, if the funding ratio falls below this magical mark of 104.5, then we kind of in our simulation have this type of recovery plan, and we have this curtailments, or in economic scenarios where things are going really well, there can also be additional indexations to the participants. And then we're going to look at the Canadian regulation. And there, basically, we're going to follow an annual indexation by the price, by the price index. We're going to look at both the case when if there is underfunding, that the sponsor is able to make special payments. But what we're also going to look at is to make, let's say, the comparison with the Dutch system a little bit more fair. Otherwise, let's say the Canadian system is always looking fantastic because the sponsor is always bailing out the pension fund and always getting the pension fund out of trouble. Is look at the probability when there is a very bad economic scenario, then we believe it is quite likely that the assets of the pension funds are doing badly, and simultaneously that the sponsor also falls away. And then, of course, you are a lot more vulnerable in the Canadian system, where basically you rely quite heavily on the sponsor being able to make the special payments. And basically to make the outcomes also a little bit more comparable, we kind of made the following assumption. Again, under the no regulation, we kind of say the benefits are cut at retirement. And under the Canadian regulation, we kind of split the benefits into a so-called sponsor part and the fund part. Again, to kind of because the sponsor is so important in bad economic scenarios, we're gonna want to filter out a little bit how much did the sponsor pay to the final pension result at the end, and how much was the fund able to contribute to the final results. So are there any questions so far at this point? Because I have three more slides left. I think I'm running a little bit ahead of time, and there we have some results of better comparison of the outcomes I want to show.
Go ahead, Anton.
Sorry?
Go ahead.
Yep. So here is the first type of graph that we made, and this is a comparison of the funding ratio. So this is like the market value of the assets divided by the market value of the liabilities. And then you see quite a big difference between the red and the orange, or the red and the yellow are the Canadian results. And the blue and the green lines over here. If I move my mouse, do you also see the mouse or not?
Unfortunately not.
Okay. So then kind of the white blue and green lines are the let's say the distribution under the no regulation system and under the Dutch regulation system. And the red and orange lines are the result of the Canadian system. And in the Canadian system, when there is a sponsor there, you are kind of very effectively kind of concentrating the funding ratio of the pension fund around the 100% mark, because in bad economic scenarios, the sponsor can kind of put in extra money. And in very good economic scenarios, you can kind of pay out the surplus back to the sponsor again. And that leads to kind of a very effective concentration of the funding ratio of Canadian pension funds around the 100% mark. Whereas the green line is the, let's say, the probability distribution of the funding ratio for the unregulated pension funds. And therefore, the unregulated pension fund, we see a much wider distribution, basically because the pension fund it's on its own, quote unquote. So it's only the accumulation of investment results that can be used to make the payments, to make the pension payments to the participants. So then we get a fairly wide probability distribution, but because on average, you make a positive return on your investment, the peak of that probability distribution is sitting somewhere around 150%. But the variance or the standard deviation of distribution is much, much wider than under the Canadian system. And then if you look very carefully, you can kind of see a small difference between the green and the blue line. And that is kind of the impact of the Dutch regulation. So the blue line has a little bit less probability of getting to funding ratios below 100%. And that's kind of the effect of the, let's say, of the Dutch regulation is kind of taking away a little bit of that probability mass of those very, of those bad outcomes where the funding ratio is below 100%. So you do see a little bit of effect of the Dutch regulation, but at least in this graph, it is not extremely effective. It's taking away a little bit of the probability mass of the scenarios where the nominal funding ratio is below 100%. But it's not kind of, let's say, that effect. When I saw the graph for the first time, I said to the student, well, did you calculate this right? And can we double check and triple check the results? Because yeah, I was also slightly disappointed that the effect was relatively small. When we look at real pensions, so the first graph was kind of the funding ratio in terms of nominal pensions, and there you kind of would expect to see the most impact of the Dutch regulation system, because the Dutch pension fund regulation system tries to avoid nominal funding ratios below 100% or below 104%. When we look at real pensions, which I think has, so when we take the inflation into account, there, I think this is for the participants much more interesting. I think it was kind of a design flaw in the Dutch system to focus so much on nominal pensions. I think if you want to protect the interest of participants in the system, you should be looking at real pensions. So the pension benefit with price, with either with inflation compensation or with price indexation. And what we did here for the Canadian system is we also took this kind of sponsor failure into account, where we kind of, let's say, enhance our simulation by saying if we are in a really bad economic scenario, and I think this is something like if equity prices drop with more than 30% within a year, then we also assume that in that, let's say, kind of economic stress scenario, then also the sponsor falls away. And then if you then look, but you have to look rather closely, again, the red line is the real accrued, the probability distribution of real accrued pensions under the Canadian system. And then on average, the Canadian system leads to a slightly better result, but because of this vulnerability to the sponsor falling away, you do have a fatter left tail on the left. If things go economically really bad and your sponsor falls away, then kind of in the Canadian system, you are kind of left on your own as a participant in a pension fund. And the impact of the Dutch system, regulation system, is again fairly small, because again you kind of see that if you regulate on a nominal basis, this is not very effective in getting kind of, let's say, controlling the real pension outcome for the participants. So the impact, if you look at kind of the blue and the green lines, so that probability distribution is maybe slightly thinner than the Canadian probability distribution, but basically the difference between, in terms of real accrued pensions, between the unregulated pension fund and the Dutch regulation is quite small in this probability distribution. So any questions so far on these graphs here? I think not. Then I basically am already arriving at my final slide. I think that the people from the pension hub, they put the fear of God into me and they said, don't speak longer than 1 hour. So now I think I've rushed a little bit too much.
That's fine, Anto. I've got to admit, Anto, I was quite surprised, despite the fact that with your additional constraints on the short term for the Dutch system, there seems to be very little difference between an unregulated system and the Dutch system.
Yes. And I kind of, let's say, we really triple and quadruple checked this, because when I saw this initial results coming out of that simulation, I could not believe that result myself. But we looked we looked fairly deeply into this, and then we have convinced ourselves that this indeed, especially in terms of real pensions, that I was kind of feeling more convinced about that. If you do a nominal type of regulation, that is really not effective to kind of, let's say, protecting your participants in the pension fund and on a real basis.
Mm, okay. So we did put the fear of God into Anton to make sure there was time for questions. So those who wish to ask their questions, please put into the chat screen, and then we'll pick that up. But I'm going to put you on the spot now, Anton. And we did originally position this as which system is better. In your opinion, which system is better and why?
Yes. So I'm going to answer the question in terms of the regulation system. So we looked at the Dutch pension supervision versus the Canadian pension supervision. I think I think the first takeaway is the Dutch pension system was very strongly nominal. That's kind of focused on nominal pension value, and that is really ineffective for kind of, let's say, protecting what I believe that you really should be doing, is protecting the real pension benefits of participants. Again, because you are looking over such a long horizon, over 40 years. When we are looking over such a long horizon, we should always be looking in real terms, and we should really not be looking in nominal terms. So from that point of view, the Canadian system is more effective in kind of, let's say, protecting the real benefits in real terms for the pension participants. But that protection is only effective if the sponsor remains there.
Yes.
So then I believe that, conditional on the sponsor surviving, the Canadian supervision is very effective and very good. But oh dear, you are taking quite a large punt on the sponsor, let's say, being there and surviving.
So talking about the sponsors, and we have a question from Laurie. Was there any analysis on the total sponsor cost?
Yes, but in the interest of brevity, so we looked at that, and of course you see there is, let's say, in the bad economic scenarios, sponsors make huge contributions to kind of, let's say, prep up the, let's say, make huge contributions to the outcomes of the pension funds. And that is kind of, and that's what triggered us to kind of say, well, that's very tricky, because especially in those bad economic scenarios, then we feel it is more likely than average that also the sponsor will kind of fall over.
Yeah.
And that's I think is something where the Canadian supervision system is very vulnerable there.
Question from Nadine is, can you elaborate a little bit more on this solidarity buffer that you guys are talking about in discussion with?
Yes. I'm happy to talk about that. So let's say the way that the new Dutch pension system is basically going to set up is that they say we're going to take of every euro of premium that you're going to pay. No, let me take one step back. In principle, it's going to be a DC type of system where each individual participant in the pension fund will have their own individual kind of, let's say, little pot of money. So that is dedicated to each individual person. So from that perspective, it looks very much like a defined contribution system.
Okay.
However, what happens is that for every euro of premium that you are paying, 90% goes into your individual pot of money, and then 10% goes to this kind of, let's say, to the pension fund in general, to the solidarity buffer. And then this solidarity buffer is going to be, let's say, kind of invested in risky assets, let's say in riskless and risky. So it's going to follow the general investment strategy of the pension fund as a whole. And then there is kind of a reallocation system that when there are kind of excess returns being made, or when there are returns below a certain minimum value, then let's say that excess amount of money that's being paid on this kind of 10% solidarity buffer is then being allocated back to the participants of the pension fund. With the idea is that there is some form of smoothing over time of the returns in the pension fund.
Can you elaborate further on the, I guess, the mechanics of how an intergenerational counter-cyclical buffer is going to be set up? Isn't that opens up so many complications?
Yes, what I find absolutely fascinating is that the way that the Dutch compromise was reached is by saying, it was kind of, let's say, as a compromise or a negotiation token that said, yes, there will be some form of solidarity buffer, and that was given as a goodwill token to the Dutch labor unions. But then they said, how this all going to work exactly, we're going to push forward, and we're going to leave that to a later negotiation round.
Oh, okay.
And we're going to basically push that forward to the experts to kind of figure out how this is going to work. And that's exactly the phase where we are. So we have this kind of, let's say, overall umbrella agreement that says there should be some form of a solidarity agreement. And the labor unions are so happy that they basically said, well, we have solved all the problems for our members, because there will be intergenerational solidarity and there will be no more lucky and unlucky generations. And now, let's say, a whole bunch of Netspar is also heavily involved in this in terms of expert and civil servants and negotiators. They are now hammering out the details of how this redistribution scheme is going to work.
Okay. We have a question from George.
Yes.
Have you considered the enhanced going concern funding regimes being implemented in various Canadian pension jurisdictions?
Ooh, what can you explain a little bit more? What that actually means?
I have to admit, I'm not sure. George, would you like to either put in further information in the chat, or we could put you online? In the meantime, I'll jump into Mary's question while George fills us in with more information. Will the new Dutch defined contribution plan involve mandatory and annuitization? If excess returns happen at the same time as low interest rates, then are they really in excess?
What is mandatory annuitization?
Once again, Mary, I'm not exactly sure what you mean by this. Right, which case I'm going to skip to another question of mine. So with the Dutch focus on the short term, how much does market volatility play in creating buffers, as in unnecessary buffers?
That was initially kind of the concern, but I think the last 20 years we've only seen interest rates just falling, and just the pension funds were scrambling to kind of keep their pen. They saw their funding ratios go down only. So there was indeed, let's say, it used to be the case that it was on the 31st of December, and then people said, well, that's just an arbitrary photo in time. So then they said, well, you can take the moving average of the last 12 funding ratios of the last 12 months. So they were just the Dutch regulator and the Dutch pension sector were scrambling to kind of cope with kind of the nightmare scenario of just interest rates going down. So this kind of market-based supervision was kind of introduced at kind of the worst possible time, that after the law was introduced around 2000. And from that time onward, interest rates went down. And we had two juicy financial crises in between, which was not helping. And then the Dutch or the European Central Bank started pulling interest rates down even further. So that really, then market valuation really doesn't help you.
Yes, it certainly doesn't.
Yeah.
Actually, Karen, would you be able to put George on live so he can ask his question directly?
George can go ahead and ask his question.
Oh, hi. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
The Canadian provinces have implemented a so-called going concern plus funding regime to replace the old funding regime. This new funding regime would require the addition of a funding buffer to the going concern funding target, while at the same time, they reduce the reliance on funding based on solvency. So it gives a quite different funding pictures when comparing to the old funding regime, which basically is reflected in still being pursued by the federal jurisdictions. But the other jurisdictions like Ontario, Quebec, and British Columbia, they all moved to this new going concern plus funding regime. So I think it'll be interesting to make some comparison how this new funding regime would differ from the old funding regime, as well as in comparison with the Dutch regulatory regime.
Yes, I think that would be very interesting. It's also very good input. From a Dutch perspective, I'm a little bit worried that, let's say, if you talk about going concern and if you are allowed to use your own expectation of your future investment returns, I always find that a little bit tricky to kind of, let's say, base your own calculation on. That's also what a lot of American pension funds suffer from a lot, that they are allowed to at least from a European point of view, work with very optimistic assumptions about what their future investment returns are going to be. And then, of course, if you are going to make fantastic returns in the future, all your problems melt away. So that's kind of that would be kind of my first shooting from the hip comments on this.
And getting back to Mary's question in regards to the Dutch defined contribution plan, whether you're able to take it out as a lump sum, or does it have to be amortized as a pension?
Okay, yes. I think that is changing a little bit. It used to be the case that you had this kind of mandatory annuitization, so you would get simply a monthly pension from that. I think the regulation has changed and there is a bit of flexibility that you are allowed to take a portion of your money, kind of taking it out lump sum. But the Dutch regulator is really careful there. They are very worried that, of course, people just take out all the cash and then they do very nice stuff and take a beautiful Caribbean cruise and then all the pension money is gone. And then they come to the Dutch state saying, oh, sorry, I lost all my money. Can you help me? So I think the Dutch regulator and also kind of the Dutch feeling is we should be really careful and we should kind of nudging people towards doing a annuitization.
Okay, so we've only got a couple more minutes left, Anton. I'm going to leave it with you to have any final comments you wish to pass to our audience.
I would like to thank you very much for this opportunity to speak to you and also thank everybody for their comments and their suggestions and their input. That's very helpful for us.
Well, thank you very much. It was great having you here, and thank you to everyone in the audience.